Almudena Bernabeu is an international attorney, and she's the co-founder and director of Guernica 37 International Justice Chamber. This office has done extraordinary work by filing cases in the Spanish National Court, which files one of the few remaining European countries that continues to engage in an embracive practice of universal jurisdiction. And in that context, she's obtained extradition orders for the 20 El Salvadorian military officers who were implicated in the 1989 massacre of six Jesuits. In 2011, she persuaded the court to include the rape of 100,000 Mayan women in its ongoing investigation of the Guatemalan government for genocide. So her work has also led to the historic judgment of Guatemala's next dictator, Rosmont. She's the chair of the International Human Rights Section of the San Francisco Bar Association. She's the vice president of the Spanish Association for Human Rights and a member of the advisory board of the Peruvian Institute of Forensic Anthropology. And this is the group which is gathering and providing evidence on human rights violations and prosecutions. So 15 minutes, and I will send the cards in your direction as we go.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. I just wanted to really quickly say also thank you to the University of Minnesota. I was just thinking yesterday, everybody made me think of before when I was at the Center for Justice Accountability, and today as a Guernica 37, how many times I relied on the work of the scholars in the Center for Victims of Torture in Minnesota for years. And so thank you very much. It's my first time in Minnesota, but hopefully not the last. Also, I'm going to come in summertime. It's because my throat's too much. I have 15 minutes and see if I can organize my brain, the things in Spanish, to tell you everything that I want. Because in a way, this is kind of indulging me, because I have a little bit of a foot in El Salvador, which is what I'm going to talk about, the Jesuits and the two women living with them assassination in 1989. But also I have a big stake and a piece of my heart in Guatemala, as we were able to contribute, and I say with Naomi, significantly to the later prosecution of Efraín Ríos Montt by Jasmine and the wonderful colleagues in the room. But I wanted to start saying, you know, why this work. And yesterday someone asked, and Juan Mendez took the question about this universal jurisdiction and what this is. And the truth is that we don't have universal jurisdiction anymore. I will not explain again, because Juan did a marvelous job of what that capacity and faculty of countries to exercise or assert jurisdiction for international crimes. The truth is that we don't have that anymore. What we have is countries, they have a battle how to keep some of these laws in an effort to protect victims. And what we have is what we call now transnational or extraterritorial jurisdiction. It's still the crime matters, but unfortunately, whether the perpetrator is in country or whether the victim is of a particular nationality matters much more. And what we have is a very scattered situation around the world in where we practitioners are trying to get the victims to have some access to court and to have some remedy. But it's being unpopular. It's true that the Pinochet case, the Juan I think also mentioned and others, open an important era. And should I stop or slow down, which is my problem? Okay, oh, perfect, okay. Okay, so then I get to breathe. Do I have extra minutes for this? Should I? ¿Sí? Listo. Si no, luego en privado se lo digo todo en español otra vez.
Es interferencia. Sí, es interferencia.
¿Será? ¿Soy yo a lo mejor? ¿Es de
no,
my too close
la parada?
To the... Listo.
Sí.
A mí me gusta el drama, me gusta que me toque a mí. Cuando hace, I like this. ¿Sí? Ok. So I don't know what I was saying, but I'm going to start from here. That so these efforts or this so-called universal jurisdiction since the Pinochet case started also, and I think that that is the era that got me to be working very closely with Benjamin and with the colleagues in Guatemala, is how to make these cases, and I take pride in the fact that now we call practitioners or transitional justice practitioners, whatever, but it's really how to use these cases to impact the transitional justice processes in country. So instead of being a reality that was just done in another jurisdiction, whether it was the United States or Spain, which are the only two ones that I got to practice and that I can speak about, how to make them impactful in the home countries. In, you know, I will focus on El Salvador, but we'll jump also to the Guatemala example. The truth is the victims of these cases, I like to think that I exist as a lawyer because of the victims' need to really seek remedy. The victims are the ones that have been, when their country is absolutely closed or denied the possibility of any justice or any accountability effort, is when they went out through colleagues, through activists, scholars, to seek remedies in another countries. And that is the story of my work in El Salvador. I started as a volunteer at a time where a number of lawyers in the United States, Doug has all that, you know, history, started looking into civil remedies under the Alien Torture Statute and the Torture Victims Protection Act that also came out in the last couple of days extensively here on behalf of victims of torture, in this particular case, an extrajudicial killing. There was one case, just to go really quickly through the legacy of the work in El Salvador, done outside of El Salvador, which the first case was done on behalf of the sister or the nuns assassinated in 1980. The brother of one of the nuns, Ita Ford, brought a case in Florida against these two generals, Guillermo Garcia and Eugenio Vides Casanova, both ministers of defense in different moments in El Salvador, with the whole cliche of living happily ever after in Palm Beach in a relatively comfortable and out of wealth, and they were spotted in the case. Unfortunately, the case, for different reasons, for a different chat or a different talk in the law school, was the jury ruled in favor of the generals. So that case kind of put a little bit of an impasse in everybody's perception of whether we should be bringing these cases or not. Another team of lawyers, and that's when I started working in these cases, decided to bring the same case this time, which I think was a very smart choice, on behalf of three survivors of torture, three Salvadorans living in exile, at the time in Minnesota, in Neris Gonzalez, Juan Romagosa, and Carlos Mauricio. And that case kind of initiated a new era, which I was lucky to witness, in which some efforts done outside of El Salvador, well, were won to begin with, some of a sense of a narrative of the abuses committed by the armed forces during the Civil War started being in everybody's mind. It opened a discussion. But I think we were missing one thing, which was the ability of these cases, in my opinion, to impact El Salvador. After that, we brought two more cases, right? Yes. And I think the one that got us together and started working really closely to see how to maximize the importance of these cases were when we filed a suit against a captain of the armed forces of El Salvador for the assassination of Archbishop Romero, the man who had been the right hand, kind of the logistics guy of Roberto Davison, the death squad master. Well, his right hand was living in Modesto, California, a lovely town if you had never been there. It's a horrible place, with all the respect to the people of Modesto, but it's, so he was, and we've spotted him, and then that's when Benjamin, and this was a case that perhaps because of the difficulty, but I think also out of responsibility, and it had been so relevant for the people of El Salvador, the killing of the religious leader in 1980, and the way he was killed, that we understood that we needed to really go back to El Salvador and work much closely with the human rights activists, people like Benjamin Cuellar, really leading the little bit of accountability that was happening. We brought a third case, I just wanted to name them, but it is finally in 2006, when we started talking about the possibility of bringing a case in Spanish courts for the killing of Elba, Celina, the two women at the university, and the five Jesuits and a priest in Arauca University. So there was, in a way, very quickly, if I may, response to the exhaustion, if you wish, of the UCA and through the Institute of Human Rights, the Benjamin directed at the time, having exhausted all possibilities of really achieving justice in El Salvador. They had filed a report or a complaint in the year 2000. They went all the way on admissibility to the Supreme Court, the constitutional chambers, that denied, again, processing the case for application of the amnesty law. When they overcome that obstacle and they got a precedent, a very important decision, they said that the amnesty law doesn't apply to human rights violations, then they apply a statute of limitations, ridiculous ruling that ended up dismissing the case. So in that kind of evil, if you wish, game is when we decided, why not? Five of the Jesuits, were originally from Spain, although out of sympathy, love, and conviction, they had become Salvadoran citizens, and they were living in El Salvador for 50 years. But they did have that tie with Spain. At the time, Spain had a law that is still allowed, de facto it was a precedent at the Supreme Court, to bring these kind of cases on a passive personality basis, meaning when you have citizens from the country, it was much more difficult for Spanish courts to deny jurisdiction. So we filed the case in November 2008, only 6 months before, without really anticipating, because we are smart but not that smart, that the FMLN will win the elections. And in January 2009, President Mauricio Funes, the first government of the FMLN, really started ruling El Salvador as it is today. So a lot of things, magical things in a way, started happening. And what we did in terms of the strategy for the case, for those who are more interested, it was the first, we decided in an effort to contribute, and I don't mean it pretentiously, but really trying to understand the opportunity that these cases provide for victims and for all of us, but also the responsibility. They become a little bit of a memory exercise, of an archive, of a source of a lot of hope. So we decided to bring a case against all the perpetrators ever identified by the Truth Commission and the different investigations, the commission ad hoc that Ruben mentioned. We tried to bring a case against all the perpetrators. So we had, and very important to bring the high commanders. There had been in 1990, 1991, a criminal effort. There was a joke, a mock trial that went after the members of the Adlakat battalion, who were also acquitted, all of them acquitted. And then only two people, Guillermo Benavides, at the time a colonel of the army and head of the military academy, and his right hand, Juicy Mendoza Vallecillos, are the two people. There's an expression in English that I never remember. They say cabeza de turco in Spanish. They had been scapegoats. They had been the scapegoats. And they were both sentenced to quite large sentences, one 30 years for orchestrating and organizing the assassination. But we decided the key part was that the high command, because of these attempts of UCA, the university that never went anywhere, had never been indicted or prosecuted or questioned. So we really started with the, as we understood it, from the high up down. And we named everybody. We think we missed one, and they ended up being added to the indictment, 5 minutes. So the case had the power, and this is something that we also did in the genocide case in Spain that later contributed. The trajectory of the case was to try to bring all the evidence, and taking into consideration that this was also 23 years after, to see if we can push some of the evidence sources. the most important, perhaps, aspects, I will say that we were able to uncover 50,000 more declassified documents lost in the Library of Congress in three boxes, lovely boxes that disappeared on us for about 2 weeks and then appear again. They are now at archive in Madrid. That we were able to get the testimony of those who around the crime had at that time collaborated with the Truth Commission, and they agreed to testify again. But perhaps the most folkloric aspect that I think is going to be very impactful and I would love to share is that one of the members of the High Command, Inocente Orlando Montano, with that name, lovely name, you got to share that with. So he was actually living in Boston, because the life is a twist, a magic twist. We were able to discover that. We relied on press and put some pressure on the Department of Justice, and he ended up being arrested about 3 years ago. Following the process of U.S. law, obviously he's in U.S. territory, he was then charged with immigration fraud, found guilty in jail. He's been now 2.5 years in jail. But most importantly is that we really gather the whole team to try to request his extradition to Spain. This was, as you may probably guess, a very long shot. The United States is not known for their international criminal cooperation on human rights abuses committed in Central America. So we thought that the U.S. was not going to collaborate. And there was a lot of resistance. But eventually, the extradition was granted based on the assassination of five Spaniards, you know, to narrow down attack to five Spaniards, which is perfectly okay. And we are in the last stages. He has appealed throughout every single step and exhausted every step of this extradition process, but he has lost all of them. We are waiting for what is called an extraordinary request for a stay before the Supreme Court, which they tell me there's no chance under the sun that he gets it. And we are waiting for him to be extradited to Spain within days. That's kind of the news that I brought. And then we will have, after 20, God knows many years, we will have a trial in Spain, Spanish National Court, for the killing of the Elba, Felina, and the Jesuits, which I am openly inviting all of you to come, because it will be public, it's open, it will be televised, and it will last a few weeks. So it will be very interesting. And I'll leave it here. Thank you very much.